So electrically erasable programmable read-only memory and its applications. So here we are going to brief about the significance of electrically erasable programmable read-only memory and its corresponding applications. So here there are two main features of electrically erasable programmable read-only memory. Look at the screen. Even though it is a read-only memory, but it can be erased and it is programmed electrically. That is, user can edit and modify the data in electrically erasable programmable read-only memory. Here you see, user can edit and modify the data in EEPROM. Correct or not? So the difference between EEPROM and read-only memory is this, where EEPROM is edited by the user, read-only memory is edited only by the programmer. So read-only memory is programmable, EEPROM is used by the user, right? User can write and user can read from the electrically erasable programmable read-only memory. That is the one you need to understand. Okay. So in the factory, some programming is being written that is happening only in read-only memory. But in the application, after purchasing the product, in that product, if we are storing some data and then we are retrieving the data, that is happening only because of the electrically erasable programming. So from this, what you have to understand, in EEPROM, we have only data. In read-only memory, you have programs. Okay, but both are non-volatile. Okay, so with that understanding, you have to proceed further. So data will be retained even after power failure, maximum up to 100 years. So some of the EEPROM manufacturers say that data will be retained even after power failure. So it can go up to 100 years, something like that used to say. So these two facilities, what are the two facilities? User can write, user can erase. Even though it is user is erasing the data and writing the data, data is non-volatile in nature. Okay, this non-volatile nature of the data and the user rewritable nature of the data, this feature is very much useful in a lot of applications. So let us analyze some examples that we can understand very well, right? Okay, so do we have any electrically erasable programmable read-only memory in television receiver is the question. So say yes or no, you assume that yes or no. If you are having right answer, you appreciate yourself. If not, you can correct your answer. Here you can see this is the television receiver. In this television receiver, do we have EEPROM is the question. Yes, obviously there is a EEPROM in the television receiver. So we'll justify or we'll check whether there is an EEPROM in the television receiver. So switch on the TV and increase the volume. For example, fix the volume is 24. So when you increase the volume means the numbers will come in the screen. So fix that number at 24, right? Okay. Fixing the number at 24 and after modifying this volume, right, switch off the TV and after some time switch on the TV. Okay, so when we switch on the TV, the volume value will remain same as 24. You have to check it. So when we switch on the TV, the volume value remains same as 24. You have to check it, right? There are two features which are you have to understand here. One is if the volume may be 10, you have increased the volume from 10 to 24. Or the volume may be 30, you have reduced the volume from 30 to 24. So changing from 10 to 24 is also editing the memory. Changing from 30 to 24 is also erasing and rewriting the data in the memory. Okay. After erasing and rewriting the data, when you switch on, this rewritten value, this 24, is permanently stored because of non-volatile nature, because of non-volatile nature of the EEPROM. Even after 1 hour or even after 10 minutes or even after 1 day, when we switch on the TV, at what value we switched off the TV, at the same value TV will switch on. So this happens only because of electrically erasable programmable read-only memory, which is very easy and very comfortable to understand, right? Mostly with the TV remote and TV itself, we are able to understand all the fundamental concepts. Why? Because that is available in our house. Very easily you can experience this. We'll never forget it. That is why these examples are given. Okay. So editing the volume count value is erasable and programmable. And switching off the TV, and after some time, if you switch on the TV, means those values, because of non-volatile nature, the volume shows 24. If it was RAM, right? If that 24 value was stored in random access memory, when you switch on the TV again, the volume always should start from zero. But it's not the case in any TV. It can be 50,000 rupees TV or it can be 5,000 rupees TV. There is a presence of EEPROM that you have to agree. Okay, so this is very important. So this retaining the value as 24 after switching off the TV and switching on the TV is happening only because of the presence of electrically erasable programmable read-only memory. Television receiver, there is a EEPROM. This is a good example, right? So another example, right? Another very interesting example is, are you able to see something, what is there in the screen, right? So this is the SIM card, right? So SIM card, it looks like a small thick sheet, right? It looks like a small thick sheet, but it has an input output. It has a power supply. It has a reset signal. It has a clock. And it has an optional USB connections, right? So it's very interesting, right? So it is also a processor kind of thing. It has its own memory and a lot more, right? So it's very interesting, right? Do we have EEPROM in SIM card? Again, the next question comes. Do we have EEPROM in SIM card? Obviously, the answer is yes. Shall we check whether the EEPROM is available in the SIM card? Maximum, how many contacts numbers can be stored in SIM card? So there is something like SIM storage as well as the mobile storage, right? If you want to store some mobile number into the SIM card, there is a possibility for us to store the mobile number into the SIM card. So approximately around 200 mobile numbers can be stored in the SIM card. So is it possible for us to edit the SIM contact? Obviously, yes, right? You can delete some 5 mobile numbers. You can add some more 5-6 mobile numbers. So erasing and rewriting is possible inside the SIM memory, right? Yes, it is possible. So after storing a new mobile number, if you remove the SIM card and insert it in another mobile, is it possible for us to see the SIM contacts and numbers? Obviously, yes. Yes or no? In my mobile phone, I am storing some mobile number. After that, I am removing that SIM card and then inserting it in your mobile phone. And then if you look at the SIM contacts, the same number will be available in your mobile phone. So editing the mobile number is possible inside the read-only memory. That is possible. That shows there is an EEPROM, number one. After editing, the content is non-volatile while, because when you remove the SIM card, there is no power supply. As long as the SIM card is in the mobile phone, it gets power through the battery. But when you remove the SIM card, there is no power supply, but the 200 contacts are stored as it is. Even if for 1 week or 2 weeks, if you keep the SIM card away, and after 2 weeks, if you insert it into the other mobile phone, and if you look at the SIM contacts, you're able to see the SIM contacts. So fantastic, right? So this is happening just because of the presence of electrically erasable programmable read-only memory. So even in the absence of power, SIM card retains the contact details, as well as each mobile number can be edited by the user, which is due to the presence of electrically erasable programmable memory in the SIM card. Okay. So it doesn't mean that EEPROM has to be available only in the form of an IC. It can be in the form of a SIM card kind of material also, that you need to understand. So these two examples, right? EEPROM in SIM card as well as EEPROM in television receiver is more than sufficient for us to remember forever the applications of EEPROM. Okay, so with this understanding, let us look at one EEPROM and let us experience how it works. So when you go for any IC, means definitely you have to look at the data sheet. Yes, there is one IC called 24C04 and 24C08 or 24C02, 24C01, which is 2-wire serial electrically erasable program read-only memory. The features screenshot is this, right? Features screenshot is this. So forget about the remaining things. You look at only the important portion, right? It is high reliability, endurance, 1 million write cycle. As someone of you rightly said, right? So it can go up to 1 million write cycles, right? 1 million times you can write and you can rewrite and overwrite, etc. So you can retain the data up to 100 years, and it is used for automotive grade and extended temperature and leak free devices. When you look at automotive grade, right, in an automobile, right, you have something like an odometer, right, and you have something like a speedometer, right. So those odometer values are stored in EEPROM. Even you change the battery of your vehicle, or even you do anything, after 2 days or 3 days, if you replace the battery, how long your vehicle was traveled, it will be displayed once again. It will never show again zero. But whenever if you travel 5 kilometers, the 5 kilometers was getting updated in the dashboard or in the instrument cluster of your automobile. Okay, so that shows the presence of electrically erasable programmable data memory in the dashboard of a car. Something like that you need to understand. It is quite interesting, right? So the same data sheet here, we are going to use the AT24C04. AT stands for Atmel. Every number has its own significance. Any IC it starts with the number 2 means it is read-only memory. Any IC it starts with the number 6 means it is random access memory. That was the strategy which was used. And the second digit 4, the 4 denotes it is electrically erasable programmable data memory. When it is 7, it shows it is ultraviolet erasable programmable data memory. Okay, so 2 means read-only memory, 4 means it is electrically erasable programmable data memory, and C means it is commercial or CMOS, and 04 means 4 kilobits. 4 kilobits of data can be stored. That means 512 bytes. Okay, 4 kilobits and 512 bytes of data can be stored in this AT24C04. Look at the description; it is very interesting, right? That's why the screenshot of the data sheet is being given, because looking at the data sheet is very important for any design engineer, purposefully embedded system engineer. That's why the same screenshot is being shared here to get a feel of data sheet of the corresponding IC, right? Okay, so AT, we are focusing on 04, right? So you see, AT24C04 provides 4096 bits of serial electrically erasable and programmable read-only memory, organized as 512 words of 8 bits each. The device is optimized for use in many industrial and commercial applications where low power and low voltage operations are essential. Okay, so though AT24C04 is available in a space-saving 8-pin plastic dual inline package, right? So you look at the screen, right? It is an 8-pin IC where A0, A1, A2 are the address lines, and there is something like ground, and it is, when it is I2C protocol, there are 2 lines, right? SDA and SEL, serial data and serial clock. So that is why it is serial memory, serial EEPROM. And this is something like write protect and VCC. If you want to do the write protection, you can give logic 1 to the 7th pin. So after that, you cannot write into this. Okay, so it is an 8-pin IC. So this is what you need to understand with respect to. Okay, so the table shows very clearly address input, serial data, serial clock, write protect, and no connection. It's very interesting, right? Now, after purchasing this IC, after identifying this IC, we have to make the connection. We have to make the circuit diagram, right? Okay, after looking at the IC, after choosing the IC, we have to draw the circuit diagram. And the circuit diagram looks like this. So because 8051 microcontroller do not have on-chip electrically erasable programmable memory, that is why we are using external 824C04. Because it is a two-wire serial communication protocol, right? It is serial IC, serial memory, which supports I2C protocol. So serial data is connected to the microcontroller, and serial clock is connected to the microcontroller pin. You may wonder, 8051 do not have EEPROM. Similarly, 8051 do not have I2C protocol also. But I2C protocol can be programmed, right? There is a possibility for us to write a program similar to I2C protocol. Okay, so in this application, the I2C protocol was programmed in 8051 to interconnect to 4C04. Even though 8051 do not have I2C protocol, the program is being written for I2C protocol, and P1.5 of the 8051 behaves as serial clock for I2C protocol, and the P1.6 of 8051 microcontroller is behaving as a serial data for I2C protocol. Okay, so when we talk about serial communication, that too, when we talk about I2C protocol, we'll talk about this in detail. Our objective is not to look at I2C protocol. Our objective is to look at the EEPROM. So electrically erasable programmable data memory is connected to the 8051 microcontroller like this through I2C protocol, which is two-wire serial communication protocol. That is what you need to understand from this slide. Here, if you see, look at the screen, 8051 do not have on-chip EEPROM. Hence, we need to interface external EEPROM. For any password-based applications, EEPROM is mandatory. Here, another interesting point you need to look at it. For any password-based applications, EEPROM is mandatory. So if you do any application, if you do any project which uses password means, So whatever password that we give, that will be stored only in random access memory. When it switch off automatically, all the password will go off. But there can be a fixed password like 1234, which can be stored in the flash memory. But it is impossible for the user to change the password. So if the password is 1234, means always the password should be 1234. The user cannot able to change the password if it is programmed through flash memory. Okay, so user can change the password, and whatever changes is made by the user will be stored in random access memory normally in the data memory of the microcontroller. When it is powered off, the changes will get disappeared, and it is again a problem. So whenever we use any password based application, it is mandatory for us to use EEPROM, something like the volume data. Here the modified password will be stored in the EEPROM. So whenever the next time means, we have to enter the modified data, and the program has to be written in such a way that to check the password, right? So those who are doing a password based projects, means it is mandatory for them to use EEPROM for the user to edit the password or change the password. Okay, that's quite interesting, right? So interfacing 240484 EEPROM with 8051 is shown here, and it is interfaced using two-wire serial communication protocol, which is called this inter-integrated circuit protocol, I2C protocol. So after making the circuit diagram, we want to make the board, and if you make the board, means board will look like this. So this board contains two EEPROM, right? I'm just highlighting this. This board contains two electrically erasable programmable read only memory, which is 240042. And the blue color box is a battery, and this is another real-time clock, which is not a part of our discussion. So this board contains both RTC and EEPROM, but our interest is to look at only EEPROM. So we are going to make use of this EEPROM. So now I have an 8051 microcontroller, and I have a EEPROM IC. So how do I check whether this memory is working fine or not? Say for example, memory has to be interfaced with the microcontroller, and the program is being written. It is being programmed, and we switch on. Data will be written into the EEPROM. Data will be read from the EEPROM, and all wonders will happen within the microcontroller and EEPROM. But as a user, we do not know what is happening inside. When you switch on, you can see only three black boxes: microcontroller, EEPROM, and that's all. When you switch off, we can see only two black boxes: one is microcontroller and another one is EEPROM. But infinite things are happening inside. But as a user, we do not know what is happening inside. So only thing is, what we need a display. That is why display interfacing is focused much before any memory interfacing, or before any other interfacing, ADC interfacing, or whatever it is. Interfacing display is mandatory. That is why we focus much on interfacing display by LED 7-segment LC. Okay. So because it is electrically erasable program read-only memory, it stores only numbers. So it is better to have a 7-segment display itself. So we should think of, okay, interfacing 7-segment display. Okay. So I need to interface a 7-segment display to the microcontroller to display the values which are stored in EEPROM, which is number one. Okay. So if there is a 7-segment display, display will show only EEPROM content, right? But I want to modify the content, something like changing the volume, means I need some volume up button, I need some volume down button at least. So for that, I need to give an input. So for that, I should know how to interface a keyboard or how to interface a tact switch with my microcontroller. Then only I can press the key, and I can increase or decrement the value. And then I have to write a code. If I press this key, value has to increment. If I press this key, value has to decrement or something. And that has to be written into the random access memory, as well as that has to be written into the EEPROM. So please try to understand. This is the way we have to understand or make it clear about the embedded system programming, right? Embedded system design, right? So even though you are learning EEPROM, knowledge in interfacing the display as well as knowledge in interfacing the keyboard is very important. Then only we can test whether the memory is working properly or not. So that is why the circuit diagram comes like this. So that is what I am going to show it in the slide also. So testing EEPROM operation here is, experiment the working of EEPROM, we need a display to see the EEPROM content. So we use a multiplexed 7-segment display board to display the numbers stored in the EEPROM. To write the data into EEPROM, we use a tact switch to enter the data. The stored count value must be displayed in the multiplexed 7-segment display for the convenience of the user. Okay. So in this experiment, for every key press, the count is incremented and stored in EEPROM, and the same is displayed in the 7-segment display. Okay, so this is the setup, right? This is setup. So this is our simple 8051 microcontroller, as I told. So this is the EEPROM board that we have seen. So this EEPROM board is connected to port 0 of our 8051 microcontroller. and the tag switch which is connected to port 2, P2.0 and P2.1. Here you can see P2.0, 2.1 tokens, and it is common ground, right? So this is ground. So one end of the switch is connected to ground and other end is connected to GPIO. That is what the circuit connection with respect to the tag switch. And there is a multiplexer 7-segment display, which has 4 7-segments, which is connected to port 1 of our 8015 microcontroller. Okay, so that is very interesting. So what we do here, we are testing the EEPROM now. So for what, for that, what we should do? We should do the power failure to check the non-volatile nature of the EEPROM. So for that, when the count reaches 11, right, we create a power cut by switching off the power supply to the kit. Okay, so when that happens, by pressing the switch 11 times, whenever volume reaches 11, right, now I switch off. Something like, how do we do in a television receiver? After some time when we switch on, normally all the 7 segments of display will show only 0. But due to the presence of EEPROM, the program is written in such a way that read the content of EEPROM and then display into the 7-segment display like that. The initialization code was written. So reading the data from the EEPROM is 11, because already it is non-volatile, the recent data is 11. So that data is read from the EEPROM and then it is displayed. So when you switch off and switch on, instead of displaying 0, 7-segment display will display 11. That justifies the significance of EEPROM, that you need to understand. Okay, look at the screen. Due to the volatile nature of 8051 data memory, the count value is erased and becomes 0. This is the usual scenario. But because of the presence of EEPROM, right? But at the same data, that is 11, stored in EEPROM 2, which is non-volatile in nature, hence 11 is stored or 11 is retained. So when powered on again, after some time or after a few days or after a few hours, the program is written to display the content of the EEPROM in 7-segment display. The recent data which is stored in the EEPROM is 11, so the 11 will be displayed in the screen. You can able to see, I'm just pressing the button, right? The 7-segment display shows 1, 2, 3, every press increments 1 count, right? It is programmed like this. So now the count has become 8, 9, 10, 11. So when it becomes 11, I'm switching off this kit. And after some time in switching on, it should display 11. If it displays 11, that justifies the presence. And the same thing is repeated again for the volume value is 24, and to justify the content of EEPROM is editable, as well as it is non-volatile of EEPROM, right? It's so 11, right? Fantastic, right? So and again, I will go up to 24. When it reaches 24, that means volume 24, I am switching off. After that, when I switch on, means 24 comes, this justifies the presence of EEPROM. If there is no EEPROM, 24 will never come. If you have worked with microcontrollers, you can enjoy this. When you switch off and switch on, means similar to this, all volume settings in the TV. We discussed only the volume settings in the TV. Similar to the volume settings, the brightness settings of the TV, the contrast settings of the TV, all are stored only in EEPROM. Because every time when you switch on the TV, we never go for brightness setting, contrast setting, and color settings, etc. Because all are stored in the EEPROM. Even in the absence of power supply, the stored data are non-volatile. So even in the absence of power supply, it is retaining the contrast value, brightness value, volume value, etc. permanently in the EEPROM in the television. In some of the television receivers, you could have noticed it, right? In some of the TV, we may, if you mute the TV and switch off, then after some days, if you switch on the TV, means the TV remains in mute state. This is also due to EEPROM. That also you can experience. Okay, it's quite interesting, right? So in modern microcontrollers, there are on-chip EEPROMs are commonly available. But in 8051 as well as in LPC2148 and all, we do not have on-chip EEPROM. So most of the microcontrollers, if this do not have on-chip EEPROM, we can interface the EEPROM like 24604 and we can fulfill the application requirement. Instead of changing the microcontroller, it is better to interface the EEPROM as shown in this circuit diagram. And with the help of this TV example, right, volume control example as well as SIM card example, we can very well understand the need for EEPROM in a lot of applications like password based applications, etc. So that's all for today. Thank you very much.